No.
Okay, so the screen share is not giving me an option.
What happens when you click screen share?
Nothing.
Maybe the best is if you leave the Hangout and come back in and see if it works then.
Okay.
Okay, so for those of you who are already watching the live stream, we're just setting things up now.
Can I move this? Can I allow the?
Oh,
I think we should.
I'm impressed by your piece of.
Okay, now it seems to work. Right, so maybe I can ask all of those who are not speaking to switch off their microphones already.
Microphone is on. It's set, huh? Yeah, perfect.
Okay, Howard, are you there?
Yes.
Fantastic. Okay, so I think we can start. So it's a great pleasure to have today Howard Wiseman, and he will talk about Belt's inequalities. And as you know, it's a very timely to talk about them now because they are 50 years old. But it's also very untimely to talk about them at 8 o'clock in the morning. And so I'm very, very thankful to you, Howard, to join this hangout at such an unusual time. So please go ahead. Thanks.
Thank you, Daniel. Thanks for inviting me to do this hangout. So yes, it's the 50th anniversary of Bell's first paper on this topic. So yes, I'm at Griffith University and in the Center for Quantum Computation and Communication Technology. Okay, so yeah, so this is more particularly, it's actually this very month, as you see here, that Bell's paper was received in 1964, 50 years ago. So you'll see that that Bell here sent his paper from the University of Wisconsin in Madison, Wisconsin. And here is a picture of Bell in America around about that time, looking very American, as you can see. But of course, he actually wasn't American. He was on leave when he sent this paper, on leave from CERN. And here's a picture of him a little bit later in CERN, because he was actually a particle physicist or quantum field theorist by training. And you can see that by the Lagrangian density hiding there on the blackboard. So over time, though, he became more and more concerned about quantum foundations and spent more time thinking about things like the meaning of the wave function, which he's holding here in his hand, until eventually they kicked him out of CERN, and he had to go begging on the streets. Of course, no, that's not really what happened, but I just thought it was curious that this cartoon of a scientist looked very much like Bell, even down to the gray shirt. No, so what actually happened, of course, is that he was feted with many honors, and undoubtedly would have been feted with even more if he hadn't died at an untimely age of only 62 in 1990. Okay, so that's just a tiny introductory biography of Bell. I suppose I should have mentioned that he was originally from Northern Ireland, but yes, yeah, spent most of his time working in Geneva in CERN. Okay, so it was 50 years ago that this paper was submitted and indeed published. So that's a long time. Does anybody still care about it? Well, yes, and I wasn't surprised that Nature, for example, had a commentary on Bell's theorem for the 50th anniversary this year. I was surprised that they asked me to write it, but that I was actually, I mean, I leapt at that opportunity because it was a chance. They encouraged me to think and say provocative things about Bell's theorem, so that was really a nice challenge, and I think it's kind of feed into some of the things which I'm going to talk about today. Okay, so why do people still care about Bell's theorem? Well, there's the opinion of Henry Stapp, a physicist in 1977, was that Bell's theorem is the most profound discovery in science. And of course, if that's true, it's not surprising. I wouldn't go quite that far, but I would. And indeed I did this year in another paper say the Bell's theorem is the most profound ramification of quantum theory that has been experimentally confirmed. So it's, I do think a lot of it. And of course in more recent decades, as I'm quoting here from Nicola Brunner, and I'll mention this paper later, Bell's theorem had a huge impact on our modern view of quantum theory and is at the heart of many protocols and applications in quantum information processing. So this talk, I'm not going to be talking about any of those protocols or applications or only very tangentially. I'm guessing most of the audience is a quantum information audience, but you probably know about these already. What I want to concentrate on this talk is really the philosophical and historical aspects around Bell's theorem, but we'll see how that ties into applications very briefly. Okay, so what is this theorem? So there's a little bit of this talk is going to be at an introductory level, not very much of it, and I know that probably most of the audience is very well familiar with Bell's theorem in a basic sort of way, but I thought it's still interesting for people to see a pedagogical approach, because you never know when you might have to give a presentation about Bell's theorem and you might like what I do, or you might not, but anyway, you can make up your mind. All right, so in simple terms, what is this theorem? Consider two quantum particles jointly prepared and then sent to two distant experimenters, Alice and Bob, who perform measurements on their respective particle. So you don't have to be an Einstein to decide that if there are correlations between Alice's and Bob's results, then they can be explained by some properties carried by the particles from the common source to the detectors. This is what Einstein believed, but you do have to be the genius of John Bell to see that Einstein's belief is provably false. Okay, so for certain sort of correlations which quantum mechanics predicts and which have now been observed, we can actually show that those correlations cannot be explained by properties carried by the particles from the source to the detectors. Okay, that's Bell's theorem in a nutshell, but obviously that's not all that I'm going to say. So what I'm going to talk about in the rest of the talk is, firstly, as I said, this is still a bit of pedagogical, a simple example showing how you can have, you know, how correlations can lead to such a profound and counterintuitive conclusion. Then I'm going to go back and talk about exactly what did Bell prove. So go back and look at what he wrote, and when, more particularly when he proved it, and this might be a bit surprising to people. And I'm going to talk about how that relates to an ongoing war over Bell's theorem, if that's not too strong a term. And then how we can understand the cause of that war, so to speak, and also a resolution of it involving thinking about causes that I'll talk about. And then I'll conclude. Okay, so what correlations can possibly be so counterintuitive as to lead to Bell's theorem? Well, there are many ways of explaining this, but I'm going to use one which the physicist P.K. Aravin came up and which he published in 2002, and it's based on something which, so my presentation is not exactly what he wrote, but it's based on it, and I'm going to say that it's based on a thing called, well, you could call it a spooky square or a magic matrix. So it's a very simple thing, this magic matrix, a 3x3 matrix for which each of the 9 entries is either a 0 or a 1. So here's an example of a matrix which is like that. Okay, but a magic matrix is a matrix like that, which has a special property, which is that each column has an even number of ones, and each row has an odd number of ones. So why would we call that a magic matrix? Because it can't exist. Okay, it's impossible. At least one row or column must fail to satisfy the requirements above. And if we look at the matrix up here, we see that the second row fails that because it has an even number of ones in it, not an odd number, whereas all the other conditions are satisfied. So when I'm giving this talk in public, I always ask people to the question, why is it that I can't exist? Why can't I find a matrix that that satisfies these? And even in a physics audience, sometimes it takes a little while for people to get the right answer. But the simple answer, of course, is that if I have an even number in each column and I have three columns, the total number of ones is going to be even. But if I have three rows and each has an odd number of ones, then the total number is going to be odd, and of course that can't be compatible. So that's why this matrix can't exist. Okay, so how does this relate to Bell's theorem? So the way it does is to think of it in terms of a game. Okay, so it's going to be a game with two players, but they form the team. They're not against each other. They're playing together. They have to convince us, the referees, if you like, that they own one of these impossible magic matrices. So of course if we ask them, okay, well tell me the magic matrix that you own, well they're never going to get anywhere because we know that it's impossible to write down one of these magic matrices. So we have to be reasonable, and so what we're going to do is, oh, and I should have said of course that the two players are Rowan and Colin, and if you hadn't guessed why they were called that, you probably will now, in that we're going to ask Colin for just one column and Rowan for just one row. Okay, so they're not going to specify the whole matrix, but we're going to ask them one column and one row respectively. Okay, and of course if they're going to meet the requirements of this being a magic matrix, then Cole's column should have an even number of ones. That was a condition on all the columns. And Rowe's row should have an odd number of ones, again. And of course the common entry should agree. So for example, if we ask Cole for column 1 and Rowe for row 2, and Cole said 0, 0, 0, and Row said 010, then that's an example of a success, okay? Because there's even number of ones here, an odd number of ones here, and the common entry agrees. Okay, but now we've gone too far. This is too easy for Cole and Row, because if they're just standing around in the room and we ask you these questions, well, Cole can always, for example, answer 000, and Row can always answer with the 1 and 2 zeros, and just make sure that he doesn't put the 1 in Cole's column. Okay, so we have to make the game harder to make it interesting, and we're going to do that by taking Cole and putting them in distant concrete bunkers. So here they are. So they look sort of similar. Maybe they're brothers, but that's not really relevant. The interrogators also look very similar, but again, that's actually completely irrelevant. We just have two interrogators, one in each room, and these are concrete bunkers, as I said, to prevent any communication between Cole and Rowe. And now, simultaneously, these interrogators are going to ask their question. So, for example, Cole's interrogator could ask for column 1 and Rowe's interrogator could ask for row 2, and if they do the same thing as they did before, then it will all be honky-dory. Okay, but can they always win in this situation now? Well, if we think about it, they're not allowed to communicate anymore. They can't hear what the other player is being asked, so basically the best way for them to play the game is to agree beforehand how they're going to answer any question which is put to them. Okay, and this might happen over and over again, so they would have to agree a number of times before, but in any individual case they're going to have to agree what they're going to answer. But of course the magic matrix, if they have agreed on what answers they're going to give, essentially Colin knows what he's going to answer for each of the three columns, and Row knows what he's going to answer for each of the three rows, and so each of them essentially has an entire matrix specified, but we know that they can't be compatible matrices, because there is no matrix where the column constraints are satisfied and the row constraints are satisfied, and they agree in all of their and it's a matrix, so that they'll actually agree in all of their things. So what that means is that they'll inevitably have to give incompatible answers, and in fact they must fail at least 1/9 of the time, because at least one of the entries but in the two matrices that they now have memorized must be different. So for example, if Cole gets asked for column 2 and Roe gets asked for row 2 and they answer as they did last time, then there's going to be a problem, because although they individually satisfy the requirements, the common entry disagrees between the two cases. So it seems like they're doomed. Roe and Cole, if we play this game over and over again, eventually they're going to be found out that they don't actually have these magic matrices that they say they do. But what if they share a pair of quantum particles? Okay, and this is, of course, the crux of the matter. So what Aravind showed is that if the Cole and Roe share a suitably entangled pair of particles, then they can win 100% of the time. And moreover, this doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how far apart they are or whether these are simultaneous questions or whatever, it will still work. So basically what they need is a device which can store a quantum particle, or maybe a bunch of quantum particles if they had to do this over and over again. And on that device, there are three different measurements which they can make. And each measurement has four possible outcomes. So, for example, if Cole is asked for column 2 then and Roe is asked for row 2, then Cole will press button 2 on his device and Roe will press button 2 on his device. Then some lights flash. Okay, we imagine these are little devices so that the Cole and Roe can see them, but the interrogators can't. And on the basis then of the results, so the red light, for example, for Cole means that he knows he should answer 110, and the blue light for Roe means he should answer 111. Say this is a code that they know, and in this case we see that they agree, everything is fine. And the point is that, yeah, as I said, quantum mechanics allows this to happen 100% of the time, whereas the reasoning we were using before said that this was impossible, they would have to fail at least 1/9 of the time. So quantum entanglement lets them break the normal rules of reality. Okay, and this is exactly the sort of correlation which Bell used to prove his theorem. Okay, so that's the example of that. But of course, Bell didn't talk about breaking normal rules of reality or magic squares or anything like that. What did he actually say in 1964 that he'd proven? So this is a quote from Bell at that time. So this is actually from the conclusion of the 1964 paper. He says, in a theory in which parameters are added to quantum mechanics to determine the results of individual measurements without changing the statistical predictions, there must be a mechanism whereby the setting of one measuring device can influence the reading of another device, however remote. And I think that's the clearest statement in the paper of what he proved then. So here he stated this as, if this is true, then something else must be false. But it's another way to think about it is that the quantum correlations which he examined violate a joint assumption of two things. Okay, so one is the assumption of determinism, which is this idea that there are parameters which predetermine the results for every setting, and the other is the assumption of locality. Okay, so he doesn't use a word in this conclusion, and what he's talking about here is the negation of locality. But elsewhere in the paper, he gives this definition of locality. Locality meaning that the results of a measurement on one system be unaffected by operations on a distant system. And you see that's essentially what he's saying here is exactly the negation of that the setting of one measuring device, that's the operation on a distant system, can influence the reading of another instrument. Again, the result be is affected. Yeah. Okay, so that seems all pretty straightforward. But what I want to emphasize, I guess one of the main points of this talk is that this 1964 paper is not the only Bell's theorem in existence known as Bell's theorem. There's also a paper from 1976 in which Bell essentially is talking about the same type of correlations, but he describes it in different terms. So first, what he does in this 1976 paper is introduce a new notion, okay, which is local causality, okay. And so he says, my notion of local causality is that events in one lab should not be causes of events in a space like separated lab, and vice versa. He goes on, but this does not mean that the two sets of events should be uncorrelated, for they could have common causes in the overlap of their backwards light cones. So now I'm jumping to a paper in 1990 because it's got a clearer statement than 1976. It says, a consequence of local causality is the outcomes in the two labs having no statistical dependence on one another, nor on the settings of the remote measurement, but only on the local measurement settings and on the common past causes. Okay. And then finally, going back to 1976, his conclusion there, the way he states his theorem, is that quantum mechanics gives certain correlations which cannot be reproduced by a locally causal theory. Okay, so you see that here he doesn't talk about two things, determinism and locality, but rather just one thing. And note that the way he defines local causality, the crucial difference here is no statistical dependence on one another in terms of the outcomes. So whereas before locality was about no statistical dependence of the choice of measurement at one side on the outcome at the other side, here he's talking about no statistical dependence of the outcome on one side on anything that happens on the other side. Okay, either the settings or the outcome on the other side. Okay, given that there are past causes which could nevertheless explain correlations. Okay, so that's a different notion. Now, in the other thing which happened between 1964 and 1976 is that Bell started talking about Minkowski. Minkowski framework, talking about space like separation, backward light cones, and things like that. So, for anyone who's not familiar with that, this is a Minkowski diagram. So, time is vertically, space is horizontally, and the diagonal lines represent signals or anything traveling at the speed of light. And so, the standard setup for a Bell type experiment is to have space like separated. Experiment so that I get my outcomes here are space-like separated, so are the settings, and they're indeed the setting here is space-like separated from the outcome, just meaning that there's no way to get from here to there via a signal going at the speed of light or slower, right? Whereas of course the source on the other hand I can have something going from the source to the outcome at so maybe I'll put that in. So these are the obvious ways that you can have causal influences, if you think of it that way. The source can influence either of these. The setting here obviously can influence that. Outcome on this side, Alice's choice, and Bob's setting can influence Bob's outcome. Maybe I should comment that I'm using these letters here. These are exactly the letters that Bell used for settings and outcomes, so I'm following his notation there. Okay, so this would be in classical physics. This would be all that we would consider in terms of what is causing the outcomes to happen. But Bell, of course, allowed for the possibility that there were other variables that we might not be directly aware of. So these are hidden variables, which just means that they're variables which we can't macroscopically verify. Okay, so we could macroscopically verify the way the source is constructed and what the settings are, etc., the experiments, but there could be other variables or events in space-time, if you like, which exist and which could influence the outcomes. Okay, so this is just allowing for all possibilities in that respect, in a sense. And so this is what Bell means by a locally causal theory. Okay, it's one in which you allow for any causes which respect the no faster than light causation, if you like. And what he was able to show is that you can't explain correlations by a model like this. Okay, this is his idea of local causality. In the 1974 paper, what he said was that if you have determinism, then you have to have non-locality. You have to have the setting Bob's choice being able to influence Alice's outcome, and that, of course, would mean by some mechanism going faster than the speed of light. Oh, what's going on? There we go. Okay, so if you like equations better than the words which I've been saying, I can set that all out in terms of equations, these distinctions. So the first important thing is to get straight that we're talking about the difference between a phenomenon and a theory. So a phenomenon is actually the observed probabilities relating only to these macroscopic settings and outcomes. Okay, so we're talking about the probabilities of the outcomes giving the settings and the source setting. But the theory then says, well, there could be other things, as I said. So that's the alpha and beta gamma, which we can lump together and just call the lambda, these hidden variables. So there could exist these other hidden variables, and in that case, the observed probabilities would result from a theoretical probabilities which are more refined, if you like, but averaged over then these hidden variables lambda. Okay, so then the notion of determinism, which Bell talked about in 1974, is that these theoretical probabilities are either 0 or 1, okay, given lambda, everything is predetermined, whereas locality then is the idea that, again, given lambda, the idea that Bob's setting cannot influence Alice's outcome. So Alice's outcome conditioned on all the things that could influence, plus Bob's setting, could influence by normal causation theory, plus Bob's setting, that Bob's setting is actually can be eliminated from that. And so I guess, yeah, okay, I've also separated the lambda into the ones that actually could influence it, but that's not the essential point. The essential point is that Bob's setting does not affect statistically Alice's outcome. That's what Bell called locality, or at least I'd say that's a natural way to understand what Bell called locality in 1964, a way to turn that into an equation. Okay, so as I said then, Bell's 1964 theorem is that there's no theory reproducing quantum phenomena satisfying locality and determinism, satisfying these two assumptions. Whereas in 1976, Bell introduced this other notion of local causality, the difference being, as I said before, that now we're saying that nothing that happens on Bob's side can influence Alice's outcomes if the theory is a locally causal theory. And so I have to consider both big B, the outcome, and little b, the setting, and say that they're both relevant. Okay, and so Bell's 1976 theorem is essentially that, yeah, the assumptions of locality and determinism can be replaced by this single assumption of local causality. Okay, and then one final equation or notion is a notion of signal locality, just to distinguish that. Again, that's not the same thing as locality or local causality. A signal locality is a sometimes called no signaling, but I think this is a better name because, of course, it doesn't say you can't signal, it just says you can't signal faster than light. So I'll call that signal locality, means that the observed probabilities do not for Alice's outcome do not depend on Bob's setting. Okay, so it's basically like locality except without the hidden variables. Okay, so and so this is the thing that we are sure that, well, you know, there's an awful lot of observational evidence that this is true signal locality, so we tend to believe this. A consequence of that, and I'll mention this later, is with Bell's, another way of thinking about Bell's 1964 theorem actually is that this implies that the observed probabilities have to be unpredictable. Okay, but I'll mention that again later, which is a different thing, again, as I said, from determinism. Important not to get determinism and predictability mixed up. Determinism is a statement about theories. Predictability is a statement about phenomena. Okay, so hopefully that clears up everything. I've explained the difference between Bell's 1964 theorem and Bell's 1976 theorem, so we can all go home. Well, unfortunately, that's not the way things are, and things are much more confused than that, and the confusion started even in 1976 because Bell himself, having introduced this term of local causality, unfortunately immediately started using the word locality as a synonym for it. Okay, even though local causality as he defined it was different from locality as he'd used it in 1964, at least by my reading and I think most people's reading of Bell's 1964 paper. And moreover, soon afterwards, Bell started implying in his writing that when he'd used locality, he had always meant local causality. And indeed, that Einstein had also always meant local causality whenever he talked about anything to do with, you know, separation or whatever, and that this was a sacred principle, that's Bell's words, which Einstein had believed in. So, as a consequence of this, followers of Bell, people who like his approach to his philosophy of physics, if you like, often state that Bell's theorem is that quantum phenomena are non-local. Whereas most physicists, or many physicists certainly would object to that, they're familiar with Bell's 1964 theorem and they'd say, no, we can keep locality if we just give up determinism, because that's what Bell, well, that's sort of the opposite the way to Bell, the way Bell stated it, but that's a consequence of Bell's 1964 theorem. So this is not just a minor difference minor misunderstanding. It actually leads to two camps of physicists who have these very opposing views. As I said, those who are followers of Bell and those who familiar with Bell's 1964 theorem and prefer to think in those terms. So I'm calling these two camps operationalists and realists. Of course, those doesn't capture everything about these camps, but I think they're useful terms. And my pinup boys to represent these two camps for the talk as I'm giving it today are Reinhard Werner and Tim Maudlin. So Reinhard Werner is a I'm sure most of you know, a famous mathematical physicist. And Tim Maudlin is a famous philosopher of physics. So Reinhard is going to represent the operationalists, and this is the typical view. So this is not a quote, but this is, I think, a representative idea of what this camp thinks, which is that Bell's theorem has two assumptions. The first is locality. Quantum mechanics respects that. The second is something else which I, Werner, call classicality, but which could also be called determinism or realism. Clearly, it is this that we should abandon. Locality is here to stay. Whereas if you read what Tim Maudlin writes, you'll get a very different picture, which is that Bell's theorem uses only one assumption, locality. All local causality, as Bell sometimes called it, but Tim Maudlin actually doesn't even go so far as to mention that, but I'm sticking it in. Okay, so he'd go on to say, standard quantum mechanics is non-local, and Bell's theorem proves that the world itself is non-local. Okay, so if you look at the last two sentences, you can hardly get a bigger difference between the conclusions of the operationalist versus the realist. And in case you're thinking I'm making too much of this, again, this disagreement, especially to call it a war. The reason I chose Werner and Maudlin to represent these camps is because there was a special issue of JPhysA, just came out just last month, special issue on the 50 years of Bell's theorem. So the quote which I put up before from Nicola Brunner and the other editors was from their introduction or editorial to that issue. And a lot about what I'm talking about today can be found in the first review which appears in that issue. But the point I'm making here is actually about some other things which appeared in that issue. So Tim Maudlin published a paper called What Bell Did, to which Reinhard Werner felt compelled to published at the same time a comment on what Bell did, and then Morden was given the right of reply to give a reply to the comment on what Bell did. And if you go to the archive, you'll see that Reinhard Werner has now written a response to the reply to the comment on what Bell did. So this is an ongoing discussion, shall we say. And sometimes the language involved reveals the feelings behind that discussion. So, for example, this is a quote from Werner's paper, this one here. Readers might be puzzled as to why Maudlin puts measurement in scare quotes. He does not explain why in his paper, but this is just what good Bohmian boys do. And Bohmian, if you're not familiar, is more or less in this context is a sort of synonym for realist. And then from Maudlin, we have him saying, if Werner had actually done us, the favour of actually explaining where C, that's classicality, is presumed in the argument, I could respond in more detail to his claim. So you see, there's not much love lost between these two parties, and I've observed this firsthand myself. I've had many discussions. I don't regard myself as belonging to either of these camps, but I've seen a lot of heated arguments between both of them, and I've had arguments myself with people on both sides. So what can we do about this situation beyond, well, okay, so I think the first thing, whoops, so this is not the, all right, sorry, I'm animation's a bit wrong there, but I think the first thing to do is to try to understand why the two camps differ, and to do that, going back to, well, I think Bell himself, who was definitely a member of the realist camp, explains very well the realist perspective on why to think of local causality as being the way to understand his theorem. So this is a quote, I think it's from his 1990 paper. He's saying, the obvious definition of local causality, which is the one that he gave, is violated by quantum phenomena. Do we then have to fall back on no signaling faster than light as the expression of the fundamental causal structure of contemporary theoretical physics? That is hard for me to accept. For one thing, we have lost the idea that correlations can be explained. So that's one thing. And then more importantly, the no signaling notion rests on concepts which are desperately vague. The assertion that we cannot signal faster than light immediately provokes the question, who do we think we are? Okay, so that's the realist camp. That this is essentially saying why we shouldn't use locality, because that's very closely related to no signaling, as our notion for explaining the localist part of Bell's theorem. We should use local causality because local causality is about explaining correlations, whereas locality is just about something which we can do, and that shouldn't be part of theoretical physics. Okay, whereas operationalists, of course, are very comfortable with using the term we. I mean, being an operationalist means just thinking about what we can do, for example. And moreover, if you're an operationalist, you don't really care about explanations. You just want to be able to predict the outcomes of experiments or predict the probabilities of outcomes of experiments. And so, moreover, operationalists could argue that, in fact, basing things on statements about what we may or may not be able to do is actually a very useful way of formulating theorems, because it can then be applied, for example, in security proofs in information protocols, which I'll mention later. Okay, so that's, I think, that's the, in essence, why the two camps differ. But I think we can maybe go even deeper, and I think it's worth doing that. And so this comes from this picture, which I'm putting up here, comes from the Austrian Academy of Sciences. So when I gave this talk in Vienna, we had a public talk from Alana Spey on Bell's theorem, of course, in this venue, which had this lovely painting on the ceiling. And here is the motto, if you like, of the, originally it was of the science faculty, or the philosophy faculty, I should say, of the University of Vienna. And I think it's some very useful advice in the context of this current talk. So it's causarum investigatio, which means the investigation of causes. And that's what philosophers were supposed to do, and that's what I'm going to do for a little bit. Now, a deeper investigation of the cause of the disagreement between the two camps, which we'll see is inherently related to the ideas of causes. Okay, but so to do this, I actually want to go right back to the very basics in terms of the assumptions behind Bell's theorem. And so for those of you who might think that I've forgotten something in terms of assumptions, this is where they'll come in. So here are these very basic assumptions. I'm going to say, first of all, I'm going to call them the ones on this page, axioms. And the first axiom is what I call macro reality. And that is that in an individual experimental run, exactly one outcome A and exactly one outcome B really happen and are not relative to anything. Okay, so those of you who are familiar with the relative state interpretation for quantum mechanics, for example, would see immediately that that's violating this assumption or this axiom of macro reality. But most people are quite happy with it, which is why I call it an axiom. Okay, axiom two, Minkowski space-time. So this just means that the concepts of space-like separation, light cones, etc., can be applied unambiguously in an ordinary laboratory situation. So in other words, that there aren't wormholes between Alice's lab and Bob's lab, for example, which some people have raised as a possible explanation for Bell's theorem. So this is just ruling out that possibility. Okay, axiom three, we could call directed causality, or more colloquially and memorably, the arrow of time, which is that a cause can only be in the past of its effect. And again, there are people who seriously would like to get rid of this axiom in treatments of Bell's theorem, but I'm putting it up there as something I'm going to assume for the rest of this. Okay, so I've highlighted some things in yellow here because at this point they're undefined terms. Okay, so I'm not saying what a cause is and I'm not saying what the past is, but there are going to be other axioms or principles or assumptions that use the same terms, and when we put them together we actually get meaning emerging from these principles. But if you're worried that I haven't defined what a cause is, well, you're right to be worried, but you're also, I can reassure you that you don't have to be, because I'm deliberately not doing so. Okay, so axiom four, free choice, again something that which people have doubted. Freely chosen actions, which again I'm just taking as a I'm not defining, I'm taking it to be defined, if you like, by this axiom. Freely chosen actions, which in the context of the Bell theorem I've been talking about before, little a and little b, have no identifiable causes. Okay, so free choices have no causes. That's the axiom. Okay, so going on now to things which are not quite so basic but continue to build on these notions of causes, I'm going to introduce a principle. I'm not calling it a principle rather than an axiom, because this is something that more people will disagree with. Principle of Minkowski causality. So it's distinct just from the existence of Minkowski space-time in that it says that in axiom 3, which is directed causality, the past is to be understood as the past light cone. Okay, and that's something which we assume we do understand from the fact that Minkowski space-time exists. Okay, so this is saying causes have to be in the past light cone of their effects. Now, this next one is actually two principles. So for the moment, I just ignore the green text. And so it's a principle of agent causation, which says simply that if an event is statistically dependent on a freely chosen action, then that action is a cause of that event. Which, if you think about it for a few seconds, seems pretty undeniable. So, yeah, I don't know, if there are probably very few people who would deny it, but it's definitely worth stating explicitly from what we'll see in a minute. Then we have another principle which I'm calling manifest agent causation, which is the same thing, except that we're now saying that the event can be observed in a repeatable phenomenon to be statistically dependent on a freely chosen action. Okay, so agent causation is a notion which applies to theories, whereas manifest agent causation only applies to observable phenomena. Okay, So manifestation causation is a weaker notion of agent causation than just agent causation. Okay, so now I can put things together. So if I take the four axioms on the previous slide plus Minkowski causality plus agent causation, then that implies locality. Locality as I defined it before and as I think how Bell meant it in 1964. As a little aside, it also implies no superdeterminism. If you know what that means, that the hidden variables have to be independent of the settings of the of both parties because they're free choices and yeah, the where they're located. Okay, so yes, okay, so Minkowski causality plus agent causation implies locality, but Minkowski causality plus manifest agent causation then implies signal locality. So quantum correlations, of course, obey signal locality. You can't signal faster than light with even with entangled states. And orthodox quantum mechanics also obeys locality, as I've said before. Okay, that as we get from as defined in the way that I defined it before. Okay, well these are going to come back. Well, immediately they're going to come here. Okay, so the idea. So essentially, as I said, operationalists like using the notion of locality as defined, as I defined it, and as I think Bell used it in 1964. And what we've seen here is that that notion of locality is motivated, obviously, by Minkowski causality, the idea that causes can only be in the past of their effects, but also motivated by this particular notion of what we mean by cause, which is this notion of agent causation. Okay, and just to go back and remind you again, agent causation being that if an event is statistically dependent on a freely chosen action, then the action is a cause of that event. So that is fundamentally, in my view, the motivation for why operationalists like that notion of locality is that it has an agent-based notion of causation behind it, and operationalists are really all about agents. Okay. However, it should be noted that although it's implied by Minkowski causality and agent causation, the converse is not true. If I just assume locality, that doesn't let me actually derive Minkowski causality and agent causation. So that's something worth bearing in mind. Okay. So another principle now, which is what the operationalists want, if they use this notion of locality and they want to say something in terms of Bell's theorem, then they need some other principle, and that principle is determinism. So I already introduced determinism, of course, in terms of probabilities, but I can give it a nice principle definition here, which is that determinism is that all events except freely chosen actions have causes and are determined by them. Okay, and where determined means, in the usual sense that if you know the causes, you know what the action, these events will be. And again, to distinguish that from predictability, which I think in this context I can state as all events except freely chosen actions have observable causes and are determined by them. So if they're observable causes, that means that I could predict them. So that's the assumption of determinism or predictability. And then given locality in this, I can, or operationalists can then state Bell's theorem, Bell's 1964 theorem then, as axioms 1 to 4 plus locality plus determinism is contradicted by quantum phenomena. And then interestingly, what we've seen is we have a stronger notion of determinism, which is predictability, because it says that that the events actually have observable causes, and we have a weaker notion of locality, which is signal locality. Okay? And it's sort of obvious, but it was at first pointed out by Masana et al. In 2006 that I can also state Bell's theorem using those other concepts. Instead of locality and determinism, I can say the axioms plus signal locality plus predictability is contradicted by quantum phenomena, and it's that form of Bell's 1964 theorem which is the one that's most useful in quantum information, so related to randomness, amplification, and quantum key distribution, that sort of thing. Okay. Yes, I think that's all I want to say on that side. So that's the operationalist approach to Bell's theorem in terms of thinking in these fundamental terms of causes. Okay, that's what they, the way they like to say it, whereas realists obviously want to express things differently, and the concept of causation which applies for realists is this principle here, which I don't really like the name, but I discovered recently that it does have a pre-existing name in the literature, so therefore I'm sort of obliged to use that. So it's the principle of causal Markovianity, or the causal Markov principle sometimes, which is this, that the probability of an event conditioned on its causes is unchanged if further conditioned on other events unless they're among its effects. Okay. So this is actually, yeah, in causal theory, which philosophers and mathematicians started working on in the 1970s and 1980s, this is the principle they call causal Markovianity. And the interesting thing is that I can take those axioms again, plus Minkowski causality, as usual, plus, oops, and I haven't edited this one. So I was calling this causal completeness. So sorry about that. So this should then read causal Markovianity. I prefer the name causal completeness. It seems to be more intuitive. But causal Markovianity plus Minkowski causality implies local causality, okay, which, of course, is the natural localist notion for realists. It's the one that people like that Bell and his followers decided. So what... So what we see is that the causal notion, okay, not the localist notion underlying it, of course, is the Minkowski causality, that causes are in the past light cone, but what's the actual idea of what a cause is which leads to this notion of local causality? And the answer is this causal Markovianity, okay? The idea that, it's an extremely reasonable notion of causes. But as you see, if you actually hold to that, then you get to local causality, not to locality, and we'll see what the consequences of that are. Okay, so just a remark that I actually have a hierarchy that in terms of causation, determinism implies causal Markovianity, which implies agent causation, which implies manifest agent causation. So these are progressively weaker notions of causation. And of course, we have Bell's theorem then in terms of this notion, which I can state as axioms 1 to 4 plus Minkowski causality plus causal Markovianity is contradicted by quantum phenomena. Okay, and that I would say is something the realist should agree is a reasonable way to state Bell's 1976 theorem. Okay, so now we can compare the operational list of assumptions with the real list of assumptions. So for the operationalists, it's Bell's 1964 theorem, and the list of assumptions are macro reality, Minkowski spacetime, arrow of time, and free choice, which are the four axioms, plus then locality and plus determinism, or if you prefer, signal locality and predictability. Okay, and so for the operationalists, the obvious thing to rule out from this list is the last one, either determinism or predictability, because operational quantum mechanics respects both signal locality and locality. And so of the list, this is clearly, you know, why would we believe that the world is deterministic, for example? It's all predictable. It seems like the obvious, for an operationalist, the obvious thing to cross off. Okay, whereas the realists have a list which goes like this. So the same four axioms, of course, but I've split up local causality now into, as I did on the previous slide, into Minkowski causality and causal Markovianity. And for a realist, the causal Markovianity is actually more important than the Minkowski causality. So realists like Bell and his followers, will say that causes go faster than light, okay? That it's not the case that causes, or causation, if you like, happens faster than light. It's not the case that causes are confined to the past light cones of their effects. So they will quite happily, well, I mean, of course, they admit that, you know, this is a it's surprising to have, be forced into this position because of, you know, relativity and success, but nevertheless they would say that that's where Bell forces us to go. Okay, so you might think, well, yeah, that's what the two sides think of their own list, but what do they think of each other's list? Well, if we ask the realists what they think of the operationalist list, the realist, you might think, well, the realist, looking at the comparison between the two, you know, the realist might say, okay, well, what I'd do would be cross off locality rather and keep this, because that's sort of analogous to what's going on this side. But that's not the reaction of the realist at all. The realist would say, look, I just don't like this notion of locality at all, or signal locality. As Bell said, this is his words, this is a desperately vague notion. This notion should not be appearing in the list of assumptions that we are even considering. It's not the type of thing that is a basis for a physical theory. And then the realist would also criticize the last item on the list, either determinism or predictability, as being needlessly strong. Okay, you say that you only, you know, this is like a fall guide, that you only have this thing which is the obvious thing to cross off because you've used this notion, this wrong notion, if you like, of relating to the wrong localistic sort of notion of locality that forced you to choose a very strong assumption here, which then nobody could object to crossing off because it was so strong. But there's no reason it needs to be that strong. As we've seen, our notion of local causality doesn't use it at all. Okay? So the realist will never be happy with the operationalist list. Okay? But what about the other way around? What about the operationalist looking at the realist list? There, I think there is actually a chance for the operationalist to say, okay, I accept your list, but I choose to cross off a different thing. I would say, as an operationalist, that causal Markovianity is an assumption that we should get rid of, whereas Minkowski-Hall causality is the assumption which we should keep. So this is the big message from this this causal way of setting things up is that we end up with a list that both parties could essentially be happy with. So as I said, so what we've gained from considering causation is a deeper understanding of why the two camps disagree and why they prefer the different versions of Bell's theorem, and importantly, as I just said, a form of Bell's theorem which both camps might agree upon. So that is the realist list with local causality broken into Minkowski causality and causal Markovianity. So it's what I like about that list is it's a list of terms which are not loaded with preconceptions, in particular without this problematic term locality, which means different things to different people, and of course with this option of for each camp of rejecting a principle, either Minkowski causality or causal Markovianity. Okay, there are a lot of other things which I think we can gain from considering causation, but I haven't got time to go into them in detail. I never intended to, but in fact I'll have to be very quick. So the other things we can gain, I think that Minkowski causality actually does a better job of capturing the localistic notion that we can for us to talk about the different types of quantum ontologies. I think what it does is show the shallowness of Jarrett's proposal of composing local causality out of locality and what he called completeness, which is also known as outcome independence. I think that if you look at it from a point of view of causation, that there's no natural formulation of this outcome independence at all, whereas the natural decomposition of local causality is, as I've said, into Minkowski causality and causal Markovianity. The other thing, there are other people who've been applying causation theory in Bell's theorem recently, in particular talking about no fine-tuning assumptions, so that's Wood and Speckens, but there's also a paper by Cavalcanti and Lal, which was just published in that same Bell's 50th anniversary issue this year. And finally, I think the using causation allows us to formulate the idea of free choice without conflating it with any sort of localistic notion, which is what happened in the unfortunate definition which Kolbeck and Renner have proposed in 2011. Okay, so summary, I'll go through very quickly. Two forms of Bell's theorems, one favored by operationalists, one favored by realists. I've advocating considering the notion of causation to understand why the two camps disagree and to find a form of Bell's theorems that both can agree upon, which doesn't have this problematic term of locality in it all. But in the end, we have to admit that we still have to give up something important, whether we're regardless of which camp we belong to or some other camp, there's some essential assumption about the world which seems very reasonable that has to be false. And so just to reiterate the list, I'm proposing macro reality, Minkowski space-time, the arrow of time, freedom of choice, Minkowski causality, or causal Markovianity. So in the end, we still have to conclude that the universe is profoundly strange. And that's just a little joke. Okay, thank you, everyone. What do I do now? Do I
thank you very much, Howard, for this very clear talk. So what happens now is that people in the Hangout and also people watching the live stream have an opportunity to ask questions. For those of you who are in the Hangout, please announce in the chat, in the group chat, that you'd like to ask a question, and then I'll pass the microphone to you.
So should I close the... Do I need to close anything?
You can keep it open, because people will probably refer to some page on your...
Okay, all right, that's fine. I'll keep it open, yep.
And for those of you who are watching the live stream, you can ask question underneath the live stream, and we will bring them into the Hangout then. I'll pass the first question to Matt Leifer.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for the talk, Howard.
Thanks, Matt.
I want to ask about this claim, the operationalist claim that orthodox quantum theory satisfies locality. Mm-hmm. I've always found this puzzling because, so first of all, in order to state that, you have to say, what in the orthodox interpretation do you mean by lambda? Okay, and so I think the natural thing to say there would be, well, lambda's the wave function. Now, if that lambda's the wave function, and you're in an orthodox interpretation in which the wave function collapses when you make a measurement, then it seems to me that it doesn't respect locality, because depending on what measurement Alice makes, the wave function at Bob's system is, one of two completely different sets of wave functions. So steering, basically.
Yeah, no, so interestingly, this is something, so I actually got Eric Cavalcanti visiting me at the moment, and this is something we've been talking about and something I've worried about for a while. So I think the answer is that when I say orthodox quantum mechanics, well, okay, different people understand it by different things, but nevertheless, I think what you're suggesting that lambda could be can't be, is not the, I suppose I should, yeah, if I go back to the space, how do I do this? If I go back to the space-time diagram, right, okay, so you see that the, where I've got the hidden variables, pardon me, how do I want to say this? No, okay, I suppose that doesn't actually answer the question. But what we have to assume in the standard, what we have to assume in the standard formulation is that the hidden variables are independent of the measurement settings. Right? And clearly that's not the case if those hidden variables, if that hidden variable is the wave function on one side, which has been affected by a measurement made on the other side. So I think that it's not so much that locality is being violated, but what's being violated is the assumption, then it would be the assumption that the hidden variables are independent of the choices. Now, the way in which it makes sense to... there are more answers. So the way in which you can make sense of this and say that orthodox quantum mechanics is local is to say, no, by orthodox quantum mechanics, I mean operational quantum mechanics, where there is no wave function, there is merely preparation devices and measurement devices.
Yeah, but
and so in that sense, there is no lambda.
But if you do that, I don't understand how there can be any correlation at all, because lambda is the only thing that's mediating the correlation.
But that's because you have a notion clearly of causation which is more in line with the realist notion than with the operationalist notion of causation. So essentially, if you reject this, an alternative principle rather than the principle of causal Markovianity, but I chose to use this one rather than. Okay, let me finish the sentence. An alternative principle is the principle of common cause. That's a principle which could have been used here rather than causal Markovianity. I chose this one because it's actually shorter to state and I think probably more fundamental. So if you reject that, which is what operationalists have to do, then you're simply, in a sense, you're saying, I don't have to explain correlations, or correlations don't have to have explanations. That there doesn't have to be a cause for correlations. When I talk about causes, all I'm talking about is this notion of agent causation. The only causes I'm admitting, you know, always exist are causes that are consequences of freely chosen actions.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
But in a sense, this is what your question is really what I was getting at in the sense that it's better to think in terms of these, to break it down the way I have, rather than using locality, to use causal Markovianity and Minkowski causality, because then we can say that if you have a psiontic view of the wave function, if you believe that collapse is real, that when Alice makes a measurement, that really collapses Bob's state on his side, which is probably what, you know, 50% of physicists believe, you know, there's some naive quantum collapse model, then that clearly violates the Minkowski causality, because you there have a cause on one side which is having an effect on the other side. So even though, you know, people like to say, you know, quantum mechanics respects locality, if you have a naive collapse vision of quantum mechanics, then it clearly does not satisfy Minkowski causality. And that becomes clear when you formulate things this way rather than in terms of things like determinism and locality.
Okay, thanks.
I think next
person to ask a question is Francesco. So if you want to go ahead now.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice talk. Here is Francesco Buscemi from Nagoya. So my question is might be slight off topic, but still within this operationalist versus realist tension that you so nicely clarified in your talk. So my question is, do you recognize the same tension, I mean, the operationalists versus realists, also in the debate about the uncertainty principle? I'm referring to the debate between Ozawa and Bush and Berner.
Yeah, that's a really interesting question, because, of course, Berner, yeah, so the other thing that, as well as bagging realists, the other argument Werner is famously in at the moment is about the how the uncertainty principle should be violated. And I think you are right. That certainly his perspective on the uncertainty principle is motivated again by these operational giving it a strictly operational meaning. Whereas yes, Ozawa's formulation, for example, I think is much more. Has much more of a realist intuition behind it. I don't know if I can make any stronger connection than that. In fact, I've had Werner tell me that what he doesn't like about Ozawa's formulation was that it's meaningless or not operationally meaningless or something. And I'm sure you know in this context that, you know, I think it's interesting that the weak values formalism actually does give you an operational meaning for Ozawa's quantities. But I still think, yeah, that's obviously not something that Werner was, he wasn't very impressed by that. So, yeah, I think you're right, but I don't know if I can draw any really strong connection, any really strong analogies, whatever.
Okay, thank you very much. So I will pass to the next person, Yin.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So at one point when you were talking about, you introduced this determinism and predictability. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, could you flip to that slide? I don't remember the number.
Is it this one? Yep,
it's that one. So in regards to the predictability principle,
yep.
So all events except freely chosen actions have observable causes and are determined by them. When you say observable causes in this context, do you mean actually observed causes or possible, meaning possibly observed causes in the sense that it's like, does this require a conscious being, or is this something where you could say, well, it's we know that this is an operationally possible thing to observe, you know, a temperature, for instance. We know we can observe a temperature on certain things. We don't actually have to observe it. We just know it is an observable. Is that what you're saying, or are you saying it has to actually be observed?
No, it doesn't have to actually be observed, because I guess the principle is predictability rather than, you know, foreknown or something like that. So it's just the idea that these things could be predictable.
There's that camp that believes that you have to actually observe something for it to be real. I mean, I guess that's more of a realist position, that, you know, there's a camp that says you have to actually make the observation for it to actually be real.
Right. Yeah, okay. I haven't really thought about it from that perspective. I guess why it's more formulated in terms of, you know, potentially observable or whatever, is that if you want to use this, as I said, in quantum information proofs, typically what you say is, well, signal locality is the weakest assumption we can make, the weakest localist type of assumption. And what we want to prove is then this, by making that and by seeing violation of Bell's inequalities, we can prove that there are events which are observing which could not have been predicted by anyone.
Right.
So it's saying, like, they could, you know, we can absolutely rule out that there is an Eve out there who knows what these results are, which I'm getting, for example. So that's why I think it's that if you want to use it this way, it's really just more about that there's the possibility for those causes of having been observed.
Okay, that makes sense. I'm passing it on to, I guess, Marco.
Thanks. Thanks for the talk, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to ask the last question, I suppose. So my question might be probably naive. I don't recall hearing the word contextuality or non-contextuality during the talk, and I just wonder what's the relation. Sometimes I think of it like that, when we discuss, for example, non-locality, let me use just generically non-locality, it's one example of the problem of contextuality, where we have the
yes.
commutation that is just due to the fact that we have separate observers. So I wonder whether that clarifies the study of correlations and what is weird in quantum mechanics or magic in quantum mechanics for correlations, or is actually something that generates more confusion, or can I approach the study of non-locality from the perspective of contextuality?
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, the answer to that is your last question is certainly yes, because some people do approach the study of non-locality from a framework of contextuality, and that indeed a demonstration of Bell non-locality or a proof of Bell non-locality is a proof of contextuality, if I understand. But I'm not an expert on contextuality. I guess Matt Leifer could probably say a lot more here. But I guess I would say, yeah, I'd be very, like, for my mind, as I've said, that in thinking about Bell's theorem, for me, it's very useful to think about it in this causal framework, causal networks or whatever. Is it possible to apply that to contextuality? It's not obvious to me that it is, that you can say anything useful about contextuality from this perspective, and so from that point of view, for me, Bell non-locality is different from contextuality, and personally, I'm more interested in Bell non-locality and related ideas because of that. But really, yeah, I mean, Matt Leifer he's the one who could probably might want to respond to that. Can we, or anybody else? Can we do that, or do you want to say anything, Matt?
I can say a couple of words about it. You know, of course, if you're talking about the standard notion of contextuality, the one that most people use, the one that goes back to Koshin and Specker, then it's composed of two assumptions, the first of which is determinism. So in order to define what it means for a theory to be non-contextual, I say that it's deterministic, and then the values assigned to observables don't depend on context. So of course, that can, so if you want to say something like non-locality is a form of contextuality in that sense, then it only really makes sense on the sort of operationalist's view of non-locality. It doesn't make sense from the point of view of the realist derivation, which you know, Howard was talking about, where you don't assume determinism. Now, on the other hand, you can look at this in the context of Rob Speckin's definition of contextuality, which doesn't make the determinism assumption. And there, the situation is far less clear to me. So you can still say that a proof of non-locality is a proof of contextuality. It turns out to be a proof of preparation contextuality in that context. And the other thing that you can say is that in that context, the locality assumption, what Howard was calling locality or parameter independence, or what, if you prefer, can be derived from Speckin's non-contextuality, but I'm not sure that the other assumptions behind Bell's theorems can. So I'm not sure that you actually do get a correspondence in two directions with that weaker notion of contextuality. So the short answer is, it's more complicated than it seems at first.
Yeah. Okay. That's. Thanks, Matt. Yes, that's much more thorough than I could answer than I could give.
Thank you to both.
Great. Thank you very much to everyone for joining. Thanks for Howard for sacrificing your breakfast. As usual, this concludes the official part of the Q+ Hangout. But as usual, I'd encourage you to stay on to discuss any kind of technical comments you might have, or how we can improve this, suggest new speakers, and so on. So the organizers will stay around a little bit longer. Thank you very much.